Welcome to episode 6 of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, Billy. I think it's the first time I've actually mentioned my name during these podcasts. I am joined by the Fair City Hooligan from Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum, Brent Carter. Hello, Brent.
Hello.
So this is going to be the first time we've got a trainee, someone who hasn't actually had a match yet on the show. So it'd be nice to hear it. How training is progressing and what have you. But of course, we're going to start with the boring questions. How did you get into professional wrestling?
God, I should have been prepared for this. I got into it properly, I'd say, when I was about 9 or 10. I watched a bit when I was younger. I remember the first time I ever watched wrestling, I was 3 or 4. It was a Saturday night and my mum was going out, so I was getting looked after by her friend who lived in the flat above us and had 2 boys that were older than me. And they were really into wrestling. And so they had wrestling on the TV and I burst out crying because I did not want to watch it whatsoever. Because I wanted to watch Gladiators, because Gladiators was on a Saturday night, and that was my thing. So my mum had to phone downstairs. No, sorry. The babysitter had to phone downstairs to my mum because she still hadn't left yet. And my mum had to promise that she was going to record it for me so that I could watch it when I got home the next day. So then eventually I calmed down and I started to watch it. And got really into it. I don't think I ever did watch that Gladiators tape because then I was pretty into wrestling. I got like the little really Hasbro figures and things. So I got into that for a bit, but then we never really had any Sky or anything that had wrestling on the TV. My mum would like pick me up some videos from car boot sales and stuff and I'd watch that. But it got pretty limited and I was just watching the same stuff over and over. So I sort of fell out of love with it as a child. And then didn't really pick up again until, I want to say, 99, 2000. Everyone in school was really into wrestling and I was like, I like Pokemon. Pokemon's cool. Do you guys like Pokemon? Was scanning through the cable channels and found ECW, of all things, and Dusty Rhodes was in it, and I was like, I remember him. He was the guy on the ones I watched before, because I had the tapes of, like, SummerSlam and WrestleMania, where he was fighting Million Dollar Man. I was like, oh, I recognize this. Oh, God, what are they doing? And then ever since then, just was proper into ECW, WCW, because WCW was on cable. We never had Sky, so I never got to watch WWF until way, way later. So I was like a WCW, ECW guy for a bit, and then they'd stopped happening because they both went out of business. So then I had no wrestling again for a while. And then eventually we got Sky, what's it, like 2002, 2003? It was like the brand split had happened. And we had SmackDown. And there was like Eddie Guerrero, Kurt Angle, guys like that. So then that was when I was able to watch it properly the whole way through. But yeah, it was a sort of on and off thing with wrestling.
So our timeline is kind of the same then for watching wrestling. I guess we're around about the same age. Obviously, I look way older. But yeah, so I started watching around about that time. Well, 99, 2000. I watched it on Channel 4. Did you see Heat on Channel 4?
Got some Heat. I remember there was a few Royal Rumbles that were on really late.
Yes, well. Royal Rumble 2000.
Yeah, 2000. Yeah. I remember being awake and seeing the whole. The only thing I really vividly remember from Royal Rumble 2000 was the whole Mae Young thing. I remember that vividly. As a 9-year-old, just like, okay, that's Don't go down WCW, back to WCW.
Back to worldwide on Channel 5, faced the remote to try and coordinate. I didn't have Sky either, so I had to coordinate my sleepovers to my mate's house for Friday night, because he had Sky, so I could watch SmackDown on Saturday, then go home on Sunday and watch Metal.
I remember my granny and granddad, they had some sort of weird, probably not legal, Digibox thing in their living room, and they never properly got the Sky channels. The channel was like the white static. If you went on the channel, you still got the audio. And I remember there were nights that I used to listen to WWF Raw, not see anything, but just listen and be like, all right, okay, I think I get the gist of what's going on. But just nothing on the screen.
So from that point, when I started doing this website and doing all this stuff for SWTV and whatnot, when I went onto like fan forums and stuff like that, you were actually one of the more prominent people I recognise from like photos in the crowd from David J. Wilson. So you went from being a fan to now you're doing or trying to do the wrestling. How did you bridge between being the fan and deciding to actually go for it?
I stopped going to shows for a while. My dream had always been to be a wrestler. But then there had been lots of things in the way of that. So then I would like save up money for tickets and get tickets to pretty much every show I could. Had some stuff go on in my personal life where I took like a step back from going to wrestling, from pretty much doing anything. I just was like working, sleeping, and like took a break from having any sort of social life. Eventually started getting back into going to some shows like Discovery, and then I ended up moving to Fife about just under 2 years ago, and not long after that Andy put up the whole starting FPWA in Glenrothes, which is only about a 15-20 minute drive away. I was like, oh right, this is perfect. So signed up straight away, because it just seemed like everything had finally fallen into place. So started, when was that, October 1st last year was when we all started training. That was the first night of FPWA, if I'm remembering right. And then, yeah, been going ever since.
So it's 6 months and then the world ended. So go back to going to shows. Do you remember anything from the first independent show you went to?
First real independent, or like, I went to a few tribute shows as a kid, not realizing what I was seeing, thinking I was seeing like the real Road Warrior.
Well, I mean, you can count. I try not to count, because I went to one tribute and that was enough for me to not go to another one. We'll say your first proper independent show.
I want to say I was like 13 or 14. Was in the Salutation Hotel in Perth. Cannot remember much about the show at all. I genuinely could not tell you anyone that wrestled on that card.
Was that a touring company, or was it like one that was run by that area?
I think it was a company from Dundee, possibly, right, in Perth. I'm sure it was. And then there wasn't many shows in Perth. So when there was, it was pretty rare. So when that one happened, I was like, oh, right, definitely. I remember at the end of the show, there was someone on the microphone saying, thanks for coming to the show. If anyone's interested in signing up for the wrestling school, then we'll take your name and phone number at the back of the building as you're all exiting. And I was like, amazing. 14-year-old me thinking, yep, okay, I'll be a wrestler. So signed my name and my phone number, and then got a phone call just explaining everything, where the training school was, and that I'd be welcome to join and everything. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. This was back in the days of landlines. So I was on the phone downstairs in the kitchen, not knowing that my mum, who answered the phone in the first place, in the phone upstairs by the living room, was still listening in. So ended the call, hung up, went upstairs to tell my mum about the phone call. She's like, yeah, I was listening in. That sounds dodgy. You're not going.
Who'd have thought it? So that was almost your first taste of the pro wrestling. So Discovery Wrestling is a company mentioned there, which is a company close to my heart, although I haven't actually been able to get down to Edinburgh to see a show, as I'm in Elgin and have bills and stuff. So what was it about Discovery Wrestling that caught your eye, about the shows, about the setup, whatever?
I remember the announcement of when Discovery was going to happen, when Alan had put out that he was starting his own company. They were going to be having a show in Edinburgh. But before that, they were having a launch party for Discovery the night of WrestleMania 30 in the bar at the Student Union in Dundee. So me and my friend Mark ended up going through to Dundee. We had tickets to go to that, and we watched, they were watching classic wrestling matches, and then they made the announcement about what was going to happen, and that their first announced match was going to be, I want to say it was Grado against Colt Cabana, but then that ended up not happening for reasons. And then they had the big whole announcement of, this is Discovery Wrestling, this is what's going to happen. And I was like, sounds amazing. Watched WrestleMania 30 there. Watched everyone cry as The Undertaker lost the streak. Whilst I'm just happy because I put a bet on for him to lose. And I won money. And everyone else was sad. And I was just like, okay, this is nice. And then went to the first show, and the first show was amazing. They're just like really well laid out. They've got a really good sort of, what's the word? It's like a good environment to be around. Like, everyone's really happy at a disco show. Like recently now we're starting to be in FPWA and doing the training, that a few of us, we've had the chance to like work setting up and doing like security in the disco shows as well. And even like the environment, like the whole atmosphere in the back behind the curtain is really great as well. Like, everyone's just really happy to be there, like put on a really good show, just make everyone happy. It's a really positive environment.
I always find with the Discovery shows, when I watch them on their YouTube and when they had their on demand for a bit, it's one of those companies that kind of bridges that gap between family friendly. You got a little bit cheesy hokiness with Gene Money, who's amazing. So that's not a slight against him at all. And then you've got the indie stuff.
Gene Money is my dream opponent. That is my dream match, me versus Gene Money.
And then you got the indie stuff, the middle stuff. They've got get guys over from Japan. You get the Bullet Club and the Elite and all that. And then you have a little bit more serious stuff. You have the actual wrestling as well. So I always found that when I watched them, you always got a bit of everything with the Discovery show. So if you went thinking, I'll take the kids, there'll be something funny will happen and they'll love it. And I'll get to see maybe someone get hit by a chair. I mean, everything will happen in that show. So you working as the crew, is it just Discovery? I know some of the FPWA guys have done Fair City as well.
Not had a chance to do Fair City. I've done Discovery and I've done one WrestleZone show in Montrose, I want to say it was. Yeah, I'm sure it was Montrose.
I think I remember a picture coming out afterwards of the crew, because Andy is very good, or the team at FPWA as well, are very good at giving the students their props when they've done that kind of thing, showing that they're paying their dues the right way of using that phrase, by working these littler shows and is it just building the ring and that kind of thing?
Building the ring, setting up all the chairs for everyone to sit in. Sometimes I'll be a runner, so if someone comes out to the ring wearing like entrance gear and then they take it off and it needs taken backstage, I'll take it off of whoever's ringside, be it like the ref or whoever's there, the wrestler themselves. I'll run it backstage back to wherever they're set up so that they can pack that back when they're leaving. Crowd control, if that's the right way of putting it. Like dealing with the public if they've got any like questions about what's happening or need any issues sorted out, they'll come to whoever's working around the barriers. Just stuff like that.
You find that really fun. Doing those things that kind of gives you a little bit of an appreciation of when you eventually get in the ring, you'll be able to appreciate the younger guys doing the exact same job. So it's a good way to do it. As an outsider's perspective, who's never going to set foot in the ring for a wrestling thing because no, No. I've done very limited like mic stuff, and I think I'll leave it at that. That'll do me. But if any company wants to pay me to do anything in the ring, then my contact details are anyway. So you get to appreciate that doing those little jobs and building up to eventually being in the ring. How was it taking your first bump?
I'm quite clumsy, and I fall down a lot. So it didn't feel very different to just general. That bump was my taking my first clothesline. Completely different story. That was horrific. But just doing back bumps was not as bad as I was anticipating. I'm saying this now and then I'm totally out of practice, and when I go back and take my first bump back again, it's probably going to be horrific, just as karma for me saying that. But no, that was fine. First time running the ropes are not as soft as you would think they are. They are very tight and not comfortable. So first time after doing a few run-ins of the ropes, I had sort of like a line bruise against my back. That's fun. But no, like back bump.
So just because there's obviously a structure in the show, I'm going to give a quick shout out to Frank at Last Minute Wrestling Podcast, because he's had me on. I think he's got your, I'm assuming he's got yourself on as a future guest. It seems to be. He somehow sparked your attention on some awful wrestling pay-per-views that you own on DVD. Like we were saying before this hit record, I also own December to Dismember. I willingly bought it. My friend willingly recorded it. And he didn't really insist on getting that VHS back at the time, for good reason. I can see your collection behind you. For those that are watching the video stream, you can see it as well. Those what not those listen to the podcast, you could have to go to watch the video.
Some of
your collection, what is the most obscurest / why have you bought this DVD? What would be it? Like, if you go to your collection and someone looks at it and goes, why have you got that? What would it be?
There's not many really obscure. I do have, I'll pull this out because I'm not very proud of owning this. I do have the special 2-disc edition of The Greatest Royal Rumble. Not that I supported that sort of thing, but it was in a charity shop for 50p, and I was like, yes, yes, immediately, yes, that is mine. Most of these are all just like charity shop and CEX finds. I tend to finish work quite early in the afternoon because I start early in the morning. So not now because everything's all closed down, but what I would normally do when I finish work is I would walk into town and just go into, say, CEX or like every charity shop I could find pretty much every day, just scouring for any wrestling DVD. The worse the better. These aren't really, I don't have that many really bad DVDs because there's not that many around just now, but I do have some really horrific WCW pay-per-views on VHS in another room in this house, which I keep getting told to get rid of because why am I still holding on to video cassettes? But I refuse to get rid of
them. You definitely can't. I mean, my old collection is at my parents', is in their loft. Eventually I'm going to have to take them back, but I've got about 2 boxes of VHSs. I'm like, I could sell them, but I have 2 boxes of VHSs. Well, I'm keeping them. Yeah, I'm exactly the same with the charity shop thing. Even though I've got really nowhere to put them, I'll still go into a charity shop if I go past and go, oh, it's a wrestling DVD there, 50p. Great. Because I found WWF branded Judgment Day 2001. 2000. It was 2001 because it was Triple H versus Steve Austin. I could be wrong. It had them on the cover.
Judgment Day 2001, Undertaker versus Stone Cold Steve Austin.
It's 2-man power trip.
Kane versus Triple H in a chain match.
That's why they were on the cover, yes, because it was 2-man power trip. So I found that and I was like, 50p, you are mine. that's kind of my bread and butter. I think my worst one I have, I own, is a 3-disc edition of The Best of Curryman in Japan.
I'm so jealous. That
sounds I went through a very long period when I was single, obviously, of going onto eBay and finding the obscurest DVDs, wrestling ones that I could find. I've got a whole edition of it was called World of Sport Wrestling, but it was like Japan. It had like Inoki and all that kind of stuff on it. It was like 10 discs of stuff that I didn't know why I bought it. It was £3. Buy it now. And I was like, yes.
Why you bought?
Exactly. That was the best reason to buy these things. I'm going to have to dig them out because someone will have some use for them that I definitely don't. I'm sure there's a teaching moment in one of those discs that someone will find useful. I'll keep you in mind if I ever dig these DVDs out. I'm gonna see if I'll keep you in mind. I'll give you the list before I put them for sale. So a lot of people would have, your name would have came to attention for myself specifically and people that follow the page through our lockdown tournaments. Specifically the tag team one, as you teamed with Big Benny from RPW as the Scrandalorians. So when the draw was made, it was by random, and this is the team that was made. How did you come up with the name Scrandalorians? Was one using the RSDM straight away going, this is the name, or was there a bit of a brainstorming session?
That was all Benny. Benny was straight on with Scrandalorians. I messaged him at first, like introducing myself, saying hi, being like, "You're tag team partners." And I was just like, "Who do you want to have as our managers?" Because the managers was the biggest thing with all the other teams, thanks to Omar with the singles tournament that made the whole manager thing like seem to be the big deal. We'd had a Twitter exchange before that where we had been paired up, and we just pretty much used Blaze of Glory gifts. So we were like, well, Chaz, Michael Michaels and Jimmy McElroy have to be our managers. And then we were trying to come up with team names, and he came up with that like instantly. And I was like, that is amazing, because food references and Star Wars puns can just be done forever. There's so many possibilities to go with that. And then once we got past the first round, and with Chaz and Jimmy, we were like, well, now we can just take Star Wars characters and make food puns. I'm really gutted that our three-man team in the six-man tag tournament got knocked out when they did, because if we had went forward, we had amazing ideas. Like, we had C-3P Oreo, who was a blue version of C-3PO with Oreos for eyes. Like, we've got Baby Soda, which is Baby Yoda holding an Iron Brew can. Like, it was just, there were so many ways to go with it, with the name, and then so many catchphrases from the show that we can just twist and add food jokes and make it ours. I was like, this is the greatest idea ever. And now it is a huge goal of, I think, both of ours to make the Scrandalorians be a thing in real life and not just in the SWN tournaments, because we had so much fun with it. And it's just like, everyone loves Star Wars. So,
and then you did the logo and had the promos as well. That's actually one of the questions we got in from people, was from Big Benny himself. It says, where are we having our first celebratory scran once we start collecting titles?
Ooh. That's a good... I feel like for us, it would need to be a buffet. Like, just load up on as much food as possible for as little amount of money. Just destroy a buffet somewhere. Like, it would definitely be something like that. Just me,
Cosmos,
our tag titles on the table with us, just taking them up as trays to hold our plates. I'd definitely a buffet, I think.
Or a bit of a teppanyaki station or something, just having the guy flipping the chicken into the middle of the belts where the bowl is. Oh, there's so many possibilities.
What a good idea, man. This works. You want to be our manager? We can do this.
That's all in my station. There's always a thing in each episode where I say that I don't like watch something. Last time was Avatar. Never seen it. Rain tried to teach me about that. I still haven't watched it. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I've only seen the original and the prequel trilogy of Star Wars. Never seen any new ones.
I hadn't seen any episodes of The Mandalorian until after Benny said that Scrandalorians could be one of our team names. And I was like, that's amazing. I'm going to go watch this, though. So I had to binge it really quickly just to get all the references, because I didn't know any of them. I've not told him that. But I hadn't seen The Mandalorian at all. But I was like, that's too good an idea. I need Amazon Prime. So, yeah. I hadn't seen it. But it's good. You should watch it. It's very good.
I'll eventually get to it. I mean, it's one of those things where at the moment, because we're working at home and all this pandemic stuff, when I finish work, I won't go downstairs and just watch something like I've seen before and I can fall asleep to. At the moment, it's Community. I'm rewatching Community from the start again. The sleep's not happening because I love that show. It's just...
When we get to the last season, all you'll do is sleep. The last season...
There was a season that Dan Harmon left that I remember not being particularly good either. That was the one where the season after this, there was a, they blamed it on a pipe leaking or something like that, that caused things to go weird. But I'm enjoying it so far. Just ended season one, so I'm in good times. That's the important bit. So the Scandalorians is going to be a thing. That's going to be one of the first things that come out. So goals. Let's go for goals. So I'm assuming one will obviously be actually wrestling a match. But is there any dream opponents you have immediately that come to mind? I know you said Gene Money was one of them.
We're in my little box. Well, it's still my little box room just now. I'm in the process of moving house, so everything's all sort of over the place. You're currently, like, my phone is currently propped against a box, and this is an ironing board that you're on. But I think I have my notebook that has, I've written down all the goals I want to achieve. I'm sure, yes, I've got it right here. I have my goals with me. So that's handy. Opponents. Gene Money, definitely. Because I think that would be an amazing match. Because, like, my character, I think, is quite serious. So doing the whole serious shtick against a comedy style of wrestling, like, because they're opposites, it tends to work really well when you've got a straight man and a comedy guy. I feel like that would be the best possible match I could put on against, like, the funniest wrestler I have ever seen, who's also just one of the best wrestlers I've ever seen in general. Like, he can do anything. If anyone saw the last Discovery show before everything all stopped with COVID, when he did, like, a proper wrestling match with not much comedy at all, like, you'd see that he can go, but he's just the funniest guy and the nicest guy. Who else have I got? Andy Wilde, obviously. Because that rates itself.
Teacher versus student. Easy.
Yeah, definitely. Sugar Dunkerton. Because I love him. And I feel like that would be great. And then anyone who wrestled in, like, original ECW is, like, a huge goal for me. The more time goes on, the less likely that is to happen. But, like, I was a huge, I still am a huge ECW guy. So to get a chance to wrestle at anyone that wrestled for, like, ECW, not, like, when it came back, but proper ECW, that would be amazing. One of my goals is also to eventually somehow wrestle in the ECW arena. I'd love to do that at some point. And then I would also want to wrestle either against and or tag with TK Cooper.
Okay.
Purely because, like, I've known TK for, like, over a decade, but we've never met. So I feel like that would be great because we used to, do you know what e-feds are?
Oh, yes. I used to be a e-fedder on the Beeble.
Me and TK used to e-fed. We were a tag team. We split up. We had a feud. And, like, I feel like that needs to happen in real life. So many things that have happened, like, virtually that I want to happen in real life. Like, the whole me and TK thing, Scandalorians, just, yeah, that's a goal. Me and TK.
Speaking of e-fedding, yeah, I did it on Bebo, and it's where I met.
Oh my God, who were you?
I went by the name of The Bean, which sounds horrific. I thought it was a good idea in my head, but I think you can appreciate it, seeing as one of your infamous moments at the moment on social media is admitting that you were the Wren Boys. So, so I think you can appreciate The Bean being a good name in mind, but not good when you think about it back. It's not great. But yeah, it's where I met Jay Hunter, who I've never met in real life, but Jay Hunter of OSW Review. And we did OSW Chat, which eventually led to him doing something way more successful and me doing this. So it's a weird time e-fedding.
Yeah.
I don't know if anyone does it now. I think you still see the roleplay ones go on Twitter.
There's still some stuff. I've seen some of the later stuff. Like, guys all e-fed, like, they'll do their promos. If people don't know what e-fedding is and they're listening to us, they'll just be like, what? But, no, I've seen guys do their promos and then they'll simulate the matches on, like, a 2K game. Like, they'll make the characters and have the matches on the 2K game and show that instead of writing out all the results, like what you used to get.
It was
I've seen a few and I was like, that doesn't have as much heart being put into it as painstakingly typing out move after move of what's going on. I think it still happens. It's just it's not as common.
I was in a very long standing feud with LAX. So the guys I was against, who were obviously friends with the promoter, because they kept winning, even though they didn't have their own names. They just took Hernandez and Homicide and called themselves LAX. It's a whole thing. I'm going to get really annoyed about it. So we'll just kind of move on a little bit. Yeah. All I'm just saying is I should be tag team champion long ago before I left that company and formed my own company. They only did like one show. Right. I've lost my train of thought there. Let's
we were on Dream Opponents and
yes, yes. Okay, cool. Opponents, any promotions specifically that you want to work for?
Discovery has been a goal since I started. Like, when I started going to training, I was like, well, I rarely miss a Discovery show since like the first show, since it first happened. Like, I feel quite connected to that promotion. So Discovery was the main one that I first put down. I was like, I would really like to work there. WrestleZone, I'd really like to work WrestleZone. I think the guys there are really great. That's a really great environment as well, I think, because when me and a few of the guys went to go do the ring crew for the show in Montrose, it was, again, like a really positive atmosphere. Everyone like had each other's back, which you don't get, I found, in some other promotions, which has been brought up recently on the Twitter sphere. One of my main goals is to be able to wrestle in my hometown in Perth. So with Fair City Wrestling happening, they're definitely a goal, to be able to wrestle like where I'm from and see like my friends and family actually watch me in a ring. That would be amazing. And Reckless Intent. It's the Reckless guys that help set up. Like, they do the main setting up of the Discovery shows. Then they're the guys that we tend to be helping out. It's like the Reckless guys and then a handful of us FPWA guys that do the setup for the Discovery shows, and being around them, like, they're really great. They seem like a really close-knit sort of family. So it'd be really great to get a chance to go to one of their shows and not just help out like with the ring with them and be friends with them that way, but actually to perform with them. I feel like that would be really good as well. They're like the main four that I've set out for myself in Scotland.
Well, speaking of WrestleZone, we had Mickey Vago post in a little question. So I'll read it verbatim. Ask him if he was unaware that someone had already established the name he's given himself, as he's the heavy metal hooligan. Or if he picked it knowing full well he'd always be the second best hooligan working in Scotland. Oof. So we've got a ready-made story for WrestleZone. The heavy metal hooligan, Fair City Hooligan. What's your response to that?
Response? God, I don't know how long... Do you know how long he's been active?
I should know. I'm like the mega fan. Yeah, you're here. I want to say at least 4, maybe 5 years.
Like, I'm only just cutting my teeth, but like the whole Fair City Hooligan thing. Well, that was on eFeds for years. Like, I've been doing that for a while. That's something. Second best hooligan. Oh, I don't know how to feel about that. The Fair City Hooligan name comes from a song called Fair City Hooligans. One of my best friends, Keith, he was in the band. They're not around anymore, but they had a song, Fair City Hooligans. That's where I took my name from. So it's not like taking anything from anyone. I didn't mean anything. I don't want to step on anyone's toes by being another. But then, I don't know, I feel there's been lots of hooligans in wrestling. There's Paul London and Brian Kendrick. They were hooligans.
That was the first one that came to my head. Yeah, it's the only one I could think of for hooligans.
There's the I want to say it's Zach and Roy, is it? The Knight Brothers, they're the UK hooligans. I know they've been going about since about, I think they've been tagging since 2010 using that name. Because I looked at that because I was like, oh, do I want to use Fair City Hooligan? I don't want to cause any bother with anyone else that uses a similar name. But I think they've had a name like that for about a decade. We should just have like a big hooligan battle royal. And then whoever wins gets to keep the name.
That sounds like the best idea. That's the best way to do it. Most diplomatic way. Everyone into the pile. Anyone called a hooligan, in you go. So the other question, three questions, it was from Kevin Williams. And he asked, he must know what your favourite dinosaur is.
Ric Flair. if anyone follows, there's a Jurassic Park Twitter account that said that the Tyrannosaurus in Jurassic Park was called Kevin the Large, so we could see him as a tribute to Kevin for asking that question.
Obviously not the large bit. Let's just... We're already picking fights with Mickey Vago here. We don't want to...
Oh, Kevin's lovely. He was... I mean, no. Oh, God. See, when I was a kid, I used to have so many dinosaur toys, and I could tell you every single one of their names... And, like, whether they were carnivorous or if they were a herbivore. And all of that went out of my head. The only dinosaurs I really remember are the ones that are also Megazords in Power Rangers. Oh, wait, hang on. For anyone that's got the video, this guy, this Lego Tyrannosaurus.
Well, that's a Triceratops, isn't it?
See? I don't even remember the name.
I only remember that because of Power Rangers as well.
So, a mastodon's not a dinosaur, is it? That's like a mammoth thing.
All I know is mastodon. This is great educational stuff for people, but all I know is mastodon is the band that I've never heard a song of, and Vader.
So, yeah, I don't know. I'll go with Kevin the Large. Let's go with that.
Yeah, I feel like I'm kind of just interviewing a mirror of myself because you have mentioned Power Rangers, and yeah, that's pretty much my acknowledgement of dinosaurs. I used to love dinosaurs like yourself, and then yeah, now it's Triceratops is Billy the Blue Ranger, and Tyrannosaurus Red Ranger, Sabertooth Tiger, you know, all the good ones, Pterodactyl, Falcon Zord. No wait, that's White Ranger. Right, we've spun off. Right, so those are the three questions that we got. You know, I think we're gonna keep doing this until the end of time. So I think we should kind of wrap it up a little bit. Because I think a wrestling podcast with the last question being favorite dinosaurs, I think that about sums up what I aim to achieve with SWN podcast. So where can people find you on the social media?
Everywhere. Facebook, facebook.com/BrentCarterFCH. On Twitter, BrentCarterFCH. On Instagram, BrentCarterFCH. Although with what's happening right now with this pandemic, I do not have a lot of pictures to be putting up because I'm not doing anything. I have a Snapchat, but again, don't have anything to send out. There's nothing there. But that's Brent Carter FCH as well. I've got a big cartel page, which is, I'm waiting on shipment arriving, but I should be selling my own little Brent Carter patches for sewing onto jackets or backpacks or anything you fancy. Because I thought that's different. Everyone's got a t-shirt. I'll have some patches. No one's doing patches. So that, I should know what that is. I think that's faircityhooligan.bigcartel.com. I might be wrong, but doesn't matter if I'm wrong right now because there's nothing on there yet. But I will put on my Twitter when the stock arrives. I think that's about it.
Is there anything else you want to plug before we...
I was going to set up a TikTok, but then I remembered I'm 30, so that's not happening. Nothing else to plug. I think, I'm not doing anything right now. I'm just working and sleeping and waiting for wrestling to come back.
So, I mean, I don't want to suggest what to do for your Instagram, but perhaps display your collection. I think that would be a good way. While you're packing up, you can kind of display your collection. Go, well, this is, I got this here at CEX. I got this at Oxfam and other charity shops. Thank you for agreeing to be on this podcast. And we'll look forward to hopefully everyone watching, listening to it, and seeing the Fair City Hooligan batter folk in the future.
Yeah, hopefully. Thanks for having me. It's been great.